Hello, I'm Tony Guida. This is My New York. The newspaper of record is in the process of correcting its record. The New York Times recently examined its 167 years of obituaries and discovered that they are dominated by white men. Remarkable people have been ignored, mostly women, like Charlotte Bronte, Ida B. Wells, Diane Arbus. Now, the paper is saying mea culpa with a new section called Overlooked. Overlooked history is one of the specialties of my guest today, Allison Meyer, a prolific Brooklyn-based writer whom you might find leading cemetery tours or lecturing at MoMA. And I'm glad she took time to be with us today. Allison Meyer, welcome to the program. Thank you for coming. You're a polymath. I mean, you write about visual culture, you write about architecture, you write about overlooked history. Where do all these interests spring from?
Well, I studied journalism, and I think that they all are about storytelling and finding stories to tell to people that I think are important. So whether it's art or design or architecture, I think it all links back to that. And the same with the cemetery tours, like it's really about storytelling and finding stories that I think are important to tell now and finding new ways to tell them to people. Because I think as a journalist today, working online, you spend so much time on your computer. So it's great to have something that takes me out of that where I can actually go see humans and like be out in the world and do something similar.
So. You studied journalism in the hopes of what, working for a newspaper or doing, did you envision doing what you're doing now?
No, definitely not. I mean, I graduated from journalism school in 2007. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the whole time I studied it, it was all about like, oh, well, you work at a newspaper, then you become an editor. And now, as I'm sure you know, journalism is much different now. And the odds of me working in print are very slim. So I think part of what's made me drawn to all these different subjects is like it really helps to be versatile in the stories you can tell, and that I can use all these different forms of media to do it is exciting. But yeah, I mean, when I studied journalism, that was right on the edge, I think, when they weren't realizing how big of a deal digital was going to be, or maybe it's just my school. Which was great.
Which was what?
The University of Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. I'm from Oklahoma originally. And I went to, and they have a great journalism program. But, you know, at the time, all the people who were teaching had all these amazing careers in print and newspapers. So what I studied, while it's great for, you know, knowing how to interview people or fact checking or whatever, it was a big process after I graduated to figure out what my career was actually going to be.
Well, I guess this is the right time to ask you, people want to read what you're writing, where can they find it?
Yeah, so I write all over. The stories I've written most recently were for City Lab, Wellcome Collection, which is an amazing museum in London. I do stuff for JSTOR Daily, which is like JSTOR, the academic publication site. Mm-hmm. I was most recently on staff at Hyperallergic as a staff writer. And then before that, I was the senior editor at Atlas Obscura, which is like a travel site. So, it's basically around. I try to write for publications that I feel passionate about and that I think are doing good storytelling.
Well, the passion is obvious in the work, at least of yours, that I've read. I have to ask you, what is visual culture?
It's sort of, that's my like catch-all for writing about art and writing about design and architecture. And I think a lot of artists aren't just working within gallery spaces or within museums. Like they're doing maybe like community gardens or public art projects. Or like I just wrote for Hyperallergic about these two artists who have a kiosk at LaGuardia Airport where they're writing stories for people that they receive on their phones upon landing. So like, is that traditionally just like art? Is it even visual? But that's my catch-all for the type of art I write about.
That's fascinating. Yeah. They write, you're landing and you get, a text or something?
Yeah, you get the story texted to them. It's part of the Queen's Council of the Arts new Artport residency, where they're putting artists in the airport. So I love projects like that, where art isn't somewhere people expect it to be.
Let's talk about overlooked history a little bit. And there's plenty of it here in New York. One can think of, among other things, the Potter's Fields.
On Hart Island.
On Hart Island, yeah. Where there are a lot of thousands of untold stories.
Probably.
Tens of thousands.
Yeah.
It's not open to the public.
No, and I think that's been revived recently because there was some recent news that the bones were actually being exposed as the shore eroded, which is a huge concern for a lot of reasons. And for a long time, there's been, including like Melinda Hunt with the Hart Island Project, people who have advocated for turning Hart Island's control from the Department of Correction to the Parks Department. So far, that hasn't happened. So like, when I visited it, it was very similar to visiting a prison where you have to go through all the security and check your phone and everything. And it's not the most friendly way to welcome people to that island, whether or not they have family there. There was some people visiting family when I was there, and you're very much confined to this gazebo just in the middle of the island. And I know people want to change that because it's not just, I think there's a misconception about Hart Island that it's just poor people or, people that people didn't know, but it's actually quite easy to end up there if your body goes unclaimed for whatever reason. I think access to there is important.
You talk about the keeping out aspect. What's it like emotionally to visit that place?
Yeah, it's strange. So you take this boat from City Island, and it's a very short boat trip to the island itself. It's beautiful. There's birds that you don't see that often in New York. There were some herons nesting there. There's this beautiful green plain that the gazebo's in. But then you're also hearing, the digging machines just beyond the trees that are digging new graves. And there are no grave markers there. There's just these white PVC pipes in the ground.
Oh, yeah. That's
the only thing to mark where the trenches are, where people are buried. So it's, and it has these old structures there from when it was used for various purposes over the years. But it's basically, it's very strange because it's a very sad place and it's a very emotional place, but it's also oddly beautiful. And I think that could make it, into a place where the public could come and still have it be a respectful place of mourning, which is, I think, what people are interested in turning over control to the Parks Department.
You were good enough to educate me and others that there are a lot of Potter's Fields in New York.
Right. Well, I think a lot of people don't know that some of New York City's parks used to be Potter's Field.
I didn't know.
Yeah, and there's when you go to Washington Square Park, there's nothing there to tell you this was once a cemetery. And same with Bryant Park and Madison Square Park. And at least in Washington Square Park, there are definitely still burials there. When they did the recent reconstruction where they moved the fountain, they actually had to make it less deep than originally intended because of they don't want to disturb the graves there. And they even unearthed this really beautiful carved tombstone that showed that even though this was a Potter's Field and a mass grave, people still cared about these people. And that's true for Hart Island too, that I think people think, oh, well, these are just people no one cared about, or they all died in a big epidemic and they just threw them in a pit. But there was care for the people that were buried there.
Mm. I started the program talking about your interest in overlooked history, which we're touching upon now, but Allison recently conducted a tour at Greenwood Cemetery in Brooklyn of overlooked history of women, important women, who were forgotten by and large by historians in our society. And where did that idea come from? How did that?
Yeah, it was timed with Women's History Month, which is great, but it also doesn't have to just be that 1 month. But I was talking with Harry Wheel at Greenwood, who manages their programs, and trying to think of a tour that would be interesting there. And there was this idea to do like firsts, women firsts, but I thought it would be more interesting to look at women who were more like pioneers in their field or their lives. And the trolley tour was organized around them. And then also thinking about women who were involved in different areas, like there was a mountain climber, there was artists, there was a detective, a doctor. And so to show how women going back to the 19th century had these really active pioneering careers that had been overlooked maybe then or maybe overlooked now. Not all of them though are entirely forgotten. Like Lola Montez was probably the most famous person on that tour, and she's still got her name up there.
Mm-hmm.
And like Susan McKinney Smith Stewart, the doctor, her name is still around Brooklyn. There's a school named after her. So they weren't all completely forgotten, but I think they were all people who were important to remember.
Lola Montez, known as the spider dancer.
Right.
And, at one time, the mistress of King Ludwig the First of Bavaria.
Yeah, she had a wild life.
She had a very well-rounded life. I mean, she had full life.
Yeah, and it's remarkable. The spider dance kind of was like she would pull at her dress like there was a spider inside of it, and it sounds kind of like silly now, or like why would that be racy? But when you think about it was the 19th century, and only recently had women even been permitted to be solo performers on stage. So the fact she so embraced her sexuality and just like put herself out there was pretty amazing.
She's buried at Greenwood Cemetery. Let's talk about some of the other women. I was fascinated by one on your tour and one largely forgotten, I think, Caroline Weldon.
Yeah, she's a really fascinating person. And I believe the movie about her starring Jessica Chastain is coming out soon, if it's not already out. But her grave at Greenwood is actually unmarked. If you go there, you won't find her name, which is remarkable because she had this extraordinary life, but sometimes that just happens. But she was a Brooklyn woman who in the 19th century decided to go west and support Sitting Bull as his secretary.
Sitting Bull, Sioux? Sioux or Apache? I've forgotten Sue. Sioux. So she became his aide, his secretary?
Yeah, and she also painted some portraits of him. And at this, like, he had long led resistance against, forced assimilation and things. But at that point, his life was kind of confined to the Standing Rock Reservation. And she went there. And it was at this time when, the Dawes Act is dividing up land, and a lot of white people think that indigenous people are going to be gone by the 20th century, so why should we care about them? Like, the main thing we should do is just go scoop up all their bones and valuable objects and put them in museums. Edward Curtis famously took this photo called The Vanishing Race, which shows these indigenous people on horseback, like, going into the darkness, and that's how a lot of people viewed them, was they're not going to catch up with technology and society. And the government, is putting people onto reservations. So she went out there, and there is like a complicated thing with her story as being this like white savior, but she was very bold in being this single woman who went west, who offered her support all on her own. She didn't go with a group or anything. And she's really remarkable.
Let's talk about another, Isabella Goodwin.
Yeah, she was fascinating too. Like, she was in this situation, and also in the 19th century, where her husband died, and she was left to support her kids, and he had been in the police, and she decided to join as a police matron, which was a very underpaid job at the time, but an opportunity for women where you basically just made sure women prisoners were taken care of, or like helped with suicide watch, or tried to find places for their children if women were in jail. And so she started doing that, and then she just was very good at going undercover. Like, she got a few breaks where she was just kind of like a plain looking woman and could just blend in and get the clues and get out. And she would, you know, bust everything from clairvoyance to like doctors offering fake cures. But her most famous case where there was these guys that stole from a banking truck, I think about like $25,000.
A lot of money in those days.
Yeah, and she went undercover as a cleaning lady where one of the criminal's girlfriend was staying and got all the tips of where they were fleeing, and the police were able to arrest them, and she got made detective and was New York's first woman detective. And she's, yeah, great.
That's Isabella Goodwin, buried at Greenwood. A woman we may know, who may not be totally forgotten, and I hope not, is a sculptor named Emma Stebbins.
Yeah. And she's probably better known in New York than most places because she sculpted the Angel of the Waters at Bethesda Fountain, which is that angel that's so famous in Central Park. And similarly, you know, she was doing a path that a lot of women weren't on at the time, which was sculpting, and in particular sculpting marble. A lot of sculptors then in the late 19th century didn't do all their marble sculpting by hand, but she actually did. And she was the first woman to get a major sculpture commission in the city, which is pretty cool. Yeah.
And tell me about Camilla Urso.
Oh yeah, I believe her superlative is the first woman violinist to perform solo on stage. But she was a child prodigy in France and managed to sustain that into a career of performance. I heard this one story that like 300 timberwolves were slaughtered to bring her to the Northwest once, so she was like top performer. And it's funny though, reading the old newspaper accounts of her, which are really, like, we don't have recordings, so it's the best that we can get. And the way they describe her was like a statue on fire, how she performed. But then they also would say things like, oh, she was so stoic,
very
expressionless. And I just feel them screaming like, smile, smile. And it's like, the same thing people say to women now. when I went to go try to find her grave in Greenwood, I actually had to look under her husband's name because for whatever reason, Camilla Urso, that name wasn't in the database. It is now, but it was revealing that she had this extraordinary life, was this amazing, well-publicized, very popular performer, and yet 100 years later, it was very hard to find her grave.
Might you revive the tour?
Yeah, I would love to. I do regular tours at Greenwood Cemetery and sometimes other cemeteries. My most recent one was on magic and spiritualism in the 19th century, and my upcoming ones are on symbolism. So I try to mix it up a little bit, but Greenwood does extraordinary programming in like Revolutionary War, Civil War, they have great concerts, but I try to look at things that aren't being covered in their other tours and programming.
I want to talk about another one of your tours, but before I do, I want to thank you for educating me to the fact that in Central Park, there is, well, you tell me. This is about women and forgotten women. In Central Park, there is not one statue of a real woman, is that?
I think throughout the whole city, all five boroughs, there are only five statues of historic women. Women that aren't angels or aren't goddesses or aren't allegorical.
Right, that's allegorical. There may be some allegorical statues of women in Central Park, but not a historical, actual being.
Right. There is an initiative right now to put a statue of Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton. There's a project to put a statue of them in Central Park, but they would be the first. I think the closest is, we have Eleanor Roosevelt's in Riverside Park. Mm-hmm. There's a statue of Golda Meir, I think in Midtown. Harriet Tubman is a statue of her. Joan of Arc is one. I can't think of the fifth one. But yeah, there's only five statues of women who were actually historic women.
I feel silly asking this question, but how does that happen?
Well, a lot of New York statues were put up by like societies. So if you're wondering why there's some obscure like Polish hero in Central Park, it's because like some Polish society probably raised money. And a lot of the city commissioners who were commissioning these were men, probably all of them. And it might not seem like a big deal, but I think when that is what you're seeing every day of who is worthy of representation, it does suggest something about what the city thinks is important. And so I think having more representation of women in public statues would be great.
Inarguable. Mm-hmm. I made reference to another one of your cemetery tours. It was a pet cemetery tour, and there's a charming New Yorker cartoon on your website that depicts it. Mm-hmm. Talk about that and the tour.
Yeah, the cartoon's by Bob Eckstein, who's a New Yorker cartoonist, and he came along on one of my pet cemetery tours and then did this great illustration of not just me leading the tour, but actually people who were on the tour and some of the pet graves there. It was Hartsdale Pet Cemetery, which is the oldest continually operating pet cemetery in the United States. It's just up on Hartsdale, New York. Like, you can easily take Metro North, and it's a quick walk from the station. And you would think it would be the saddest place in the world, and in a way it is. But it's also just very sweet because, like you have to bury your parents and your grandparents, but you don't have to bury your dog. And so the people who choose to bury their dog or their cat or their lizard or their rabbit or gerbil.
Or their cat.
I
have a cat who's buried there.
Oh, that's sweet.
Yeah.
Did you personalize the grave?
No, I didn't personally participate. But yeah, Spike is well remembered and living well at Hartsdale, I hope.
And I love walking around there because the names are so great, like Spike, and there's some graves that'll be like We Miss You, Satan, because that was the cat's name, and it's just a great visual, but it's also very heartfelt because they do really miss this cat, and I like doing tours there because it's just such a beautiful place, and I think it's almost like a form of folk art where they've taken this, you know, very traditional graves and tombstones and funerals and repurposing it to express love for animals.
Mm-hmm. Widening out the subject of forgotten history, I mean, we have the Trash Museum in East Harlem. I was unaware of that.
Yeah.
What is that, just interesting items that have been selected from trash?
Yeah, I mean, that's it at its core, but this sanitation worker, Nelson Molina, I believe, he worked the same route in East Harlem for years. And a lot of people don't know this, but once you put something on the curb as trash, it's actually like city property, so you can't just take it. You can be fined. I mean, you can take it. But he got around this by just keeping it in the sanitation garage. But rather than just this big assembly of junk, it's so beautifully curated, and it's kind of hard to capture in words or photographs, but everything is arranged with purpose, like from the smallest like family photo to like a giant beautiful painting he found. And it's not generally open to the public, but I know that like Open House New York does tours there. And so there are ways to see it, and it's just an amazing, like, not just like other side of history of New York, but very specific to this neighborhood, because it's only from the neighborhood where he had that sanitation route.
I was saying early in the program that you have such a interesting palette of interests, and one of them you mentioned is your mission, as you call it, to see all of New York City's great trees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What makes a tree great, and besides its age, I suppose, but...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I thought that idea was kind of hilarious, too, like, what makes a tree great? And I really like weird hobbies, I guess, and I decided it would be a fun project. I started it actually in the summer because I don't like the heat, and it was a way to make me go out and do something after work.
Yeah.
But New York City Parks Department actually has a list of the official great trees in New York City, and so I based it on that.
Really? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently there's a special elm tree in Prospect Park?
Oh yeah, the Camperdown Elm, and it's right by the Audubon Boathouse. It's this really strange, like eldritch looking tree that almost looks like a giant bonsai because it's held up by wires and crutches and all this stuff. But it is a tree that can only grow by being propagated from another Camperdown Elm. And they don't grow straight up, they grow like sideways. Mm. So they just kind of like flop over and look very strange. But I love that tree because in the 1960s, Marianne Moore, the poet, was part of this campaign to help save it. And she wrote a poem about it, calling it Our Crowning Curio of Brooklyn, which is great. And they have a little historic plaque there with her poem on it. And I think like, just whether it's trees or cemeteries or whatever, whenever I have a portal to like seeing the city in a different way, it's really exciting. Anything that gets me to a new neighborhood or makes me walk down my own street and look at it differently, I really enjoy.
And how's the mission going to see the trees?
It's good. I got very close, and then I really got down to the ones that are way deep in Staten Island or the Bronx, and I do intend to make it to all of them, but I like now they're into like day trip territory, and I'm thinking about like how much do I really want to see all these, and how much was it just a fun excuse to explore the city?
Yeah. Well, there are many reasons to explore the city, and that's as good as any.
Mm-hmm.
Allison Meyer, it's a delight to talk to you, and I urge you to look for her writing online and other places. First, go to her website, mm-hmm. Allison Meyer.
Yeah.
.com.
Allison C. Meyer.
Allison C. Meyer.
Someone beat me to the other one.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you for being here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks for having me.
Okay. And thank you for watching. We will see you soon.